Blizzkin.
Kurt's just brilliant. He's the man with the best stories, the most beautiful laugh ever, and he can actually really make your skin crawl. He can be that scary.
All through Planet Terror, we're just joking that it's like a John Carpenter movie. He was, Robert was playing music from John Carpenter's Escape from New York and The Thing on the set all the time. And it became this joke that this is like the lost movie that Carpenter should have done in between Escape from New York and The Thing, should have been Planet Terror. So as we're talking all this John Carpenter stuff, all of a sudden it hits me about Kurt Russell, that he would be terrific in the role. And I brought it up to Robert. I said, Kurt Russell, and I brought up maybe three other people, but he didn't even hear those three other names. He was like, you know, that Kurt Russell, that's a really good idea, you know? And he started the brainwashing process, you know, just filling me full of positive reinforcement about Kurt Russell, but letting it be my idea. And I think by the next morning, I was, you know, I think it's Kurt Russell. I think that's maybe the way to go. I was like, yeah, I knew you'd see it that way, Quentin.
Quentin said, I'd like for you to add this to your rogues gallery of characters. And I said, boy, I'd like to do that.
Well, I'd always been a huge, huge fan of Kurt Russell from he was just him just being a little boy. And he's a little older than me, but I felt like I grew up watching him. Yeah, as a little kid, and the show and that show, and then the Dexter Riley movies at Walt Disney and the Barefoot Executive, and then along his career doing guest shots, and you know, then came Bronson, High Chaparral, Man from U.N.C.L.E., Harry O., all these different things. Anyway, I always thought he was fantastic, even from the point that the time he played Elvis, to all the characters he played in the John Carpenter films, and used cars. He's just always been one of my favorite actors. He wasn't too actorly an actor. He actually really did understand the whole concept of that actors are players. They're like, you know, children at play. And he's always done that. The slightly Eastwood-esque voice he uses for Snake Plissken, the slightly John Wayne-esque voice he uses for Jack Burton, just shows that he's not this too actorly of an actor. He's actually just, he has a sense of fun about him.
You know how people say, you're okay in my book, or in my book, that's no good. Well, I actually have a book. And everybody I ever meet goes in this book. And now I've met you, and you're going in the book.
Kurt actually understands this man. And what I mean by that is this whole kind of breed of stuntman, this breed of movie professional that almost doesn't exist anymore. It's about, you know, four generations almost away. And, Kurt Russell grew up in a Hollywood that was, you know, this generation ran the day. And Kurt Russell could as a little boy, as a 12-year-old actor on his TV show, he started in Jamie McPeters. Charles Bronson was playing under him. Kurt Russell could, Kurt could flip over a wagon when he was 12, because that was like, you know, that's how you got the job. You know, he could fall off a horse at a young age because, you know, not because like you got a stunt bump, but that was the way to get the job if you could do all those things. And, you know, that's a whole different breed of the way actors have to be now. And he grew up with, you know, his dad was a character actor, cowboy character actor, Bing Russell, that was around these kind of people, and he was one of those kind of people. And then there's the stunt people that Kurt Russell grew up with.
Back in the all or nothing days, Vanishing Point days, the Dirty Mary Crazy Larry days, the White Lion Fever days. Real cars smashing into real cars. Real dumb people driving them.
Every stunt person that I talked to on this movie, that's an older stunt person, Buddy Joe Hooker, Jeff Dashanaw, all said that they knew the stuntman, Mike guy, that they'd met that guy in the business before. You know, he had a few credits. You know, nothing to knock your socks off, but enough to say he was in the game.
Yeah, I did damn near the whole third season of Vegas. I was Robert Urich's driving double. And then Bob did another show, Gavilan. And he brought me with him on that till... And after that... Do you know any of these shows or people I'm talking about?
He dresses that way with the tight jeans and the tight black t-shirt and the bad jewelry. That's his thing. And so everyone knew, had a version of this guy. Kurt had a version of this guy. Everyone had a version of this stuntman Mike guy. And just to take him to it goes just a little wrong.
Is that cowboy wisdom?
I'm not a cowboy, Pam. I'm a stuntman. But that's a very easy mistake to make.
Stuntman Mike's maybe a little older than Kurt. You know, only maybe about by 4 years. But that's a breed of man that doesn't exist anymore. And Kurt's, you know, obviously I'm not talking about the psychotic killer aspect of Stuntman Mike. I'm talking about the breed of man that he came from and his peers and the environment in which he grew up in. Well, Kurt understands that environment very, very well.
It's a good feeling when somebody's inclusive and they like what you've done and they are appreciative of what you've done and they want you to bring things to this that make you feel like they're right there with you. I'm right there with you. You're not out there on your own.
Do I frighten you? Is it my scar?
It's your car.
Yeah, I know. Sorry. It's my mom's car.
The fun part has been working with Quentin in creating that character, and he's... it's different from anything I've done.
Get ready to fly, bitch!
Kurt's very comfortable in the cars. He's very comfortable in the cars. In fact, I was even talking to him, like, I can't even imagine if I had to do this where I couldn't trust you in the car, or I had to get you out, or just use you for just a couple little shots or anything. It just makes it so much easier that he can go and he can do it and he can actually do some hairy stuff and still act and play the character and be right there.
Yeah! Jesus fucking Christ, it's about time!
You know, Kurt's really modest about it because, you know, he's like, driving's not a stunt. You know, if I crash it and live through it, then it becomes a stunt. But if I keep it on the road, and then it's not a stunt. It's just driving. It's just driving fast, and I'm good at that. His sister was actually the first person, was the first female ever asked to drive at the Indy 500. You know, so he comes from a very athletic, macho, driving, horseback riding family. So he's very, very comfortable.
I race quarter midgets and half midgets in TQs. And, yeah, I feel very comfortable in a car. When I'm in a car, I feel... You know, if the setup is good, mm-hmm. feel comfortable, we can do most things. There's things like the blow off. I'm done with that. I'm not doing those anymore. that was an interesting experiment, you know, but it's like, no. But we've got a good mix in this show. I think, like I said, I think what you try to do is you do what you think is right for the movie that you can comfortably do, that you all feel comfortable with.
Wonderful collaboration, but I have to say, it's hinted at in the script, but when Stuntman Mike turns into just a crying bitch and just does this complete turnover, which is one of the best parts of the movie, that was Kurt. It's implied in the script that he goes there, but Kurt went there. Kurt's the one that went the whole way, where he turned into a cowardly lion, and it's just so much fun in the movie when that turn happens. It was like the greatest thing to gauge audiences with and to watch audiences just burst out laughing when it happens, and now you're watching a whole different movie once that happens.
Oh, why? Oh, no! Oh!
This is just one of those experiences where you just say, wow, you know, yeah, if everything could be like this, you really would think about doing it for nothing. But as we all know, when you go to work for Quentin Tarantino, you do it for the money. That's certainly why I'm here.
Hey, ladies, that was fun.
I've been very fortunate with the directors that I've been able to work with over the years. And in all honesty, never topped by this. This has been a truly great experience.